Hi, this is Guy Higashi from New Hope Christian College, and I'm here with Dr. Stan James. And we're going to talk about innovation and his early days in dreaming and brainstorming and thinking about the possibilities of running shoes with Nike. So here's Dr.
Yeah. Thank you, Guy. Yes, the other day you and I were talking about some of my early experiences after I arrived in Eugene back in 1967. And I came here because of Dr. Don Slocum. Don was a world-famous orthopedic surgeon in sports medicine, and that was an area of interest, so that's why I joined the group here and been here basically ever since. But Don was a very innovative guy, and things that I learned from Don I've carried through my life, basically. And in addition to Don Slocum, he introduced me to the former University of Oregon coach Bill Bowerman, one of the former co-founders of Nike. And the thing I learned from both Dr. Slocum and Bill Bowerman was that they were very innovative, and they would take ideas that had been established as fact for years, and they would take these ideas and say, well, why don't we just turn them around and take a look, see if there's something else there. And by doing that, they often opened up a brand new panorama of ideas and uses for what was considered something was pretty much, you know, fixed in stone. Bill with shoes and changing the shoe industry, and Don Slocum with principles of surgery. He could look at a knee that had had a lot of surgery on it, and I used to ask him, well, what are you going to do? And his response would be, well, we'll just do what we need to do when we get there. And that was based upon the fact that he understood the basic principles of surgery and the way the body functioned. And consequently, he could encounter situations that were not the usual and come up with a solution. And I learned that principle from him. The principle is you understand the basic principles of your profession or your endeavor, and that will allow you then to accommodate or adapt to whatever situation comes along. So it was kind of interesting. People used to come visit to watch him do surgery, and they'd come out of surgery going, what did he do? And what they were, the problem was, they were anticipating that he was going to show them step one, step two, step three, step four, that could be applied to any situation. And of course, that's not the way he functioned. So they went away a little disappointed sometimes, but the fact was, he imbued in me the importance of knowing the principles of your profession. And that's basically what Bill Bowerman did too. You know, he understood what he was doing, but he was always willing to take a little different look at what was normally an accepted mode of doing things, a way of making shoes, a way of training athletes. And he came up with different ideas, which a lot of people thought weren't valid, but over time proved to be very valid. So I think the important thing is when you start into a new endeavor, keep your mind open, know the principles behind what you want to do, and then you can accommodate to many situations.
Okay, Dr. Stan, why don't we talk a little bit more about your how you and Bill Bowerman maybe explored and interacted when we thought about changing the shoe and the running shoe. So, I mean, how did he come up with ideas? How did you folks dream and brainstorm or think about some of the new emphasis?
Well, that was a lot of fun with Bill. He always had new ideas, and he was always looking for a better shoe, one that would fit better, be lighter. Consequently, he was very innovative and very inquisitive. And he established a little research group here in town, so to speak. There were about four of us in this research group, and it was basically a matter of meeting at his house about once a month and brainstorming. You know, we didn't have any preconceived ideas. Anything was okay that we came up with. I remember one time we talked about a track shoe that only had one spike, saying that's probably all you really need. But of course, the standard was five or six spikes. But Bill was always looking at improving the shoes in a very innovative fashion. We would come up with the ideas, and one of our group could make shoes. He was a brace maker or orthotist in town, so he could take our ideas and fabricate a shoe, and then we would send it off to Nike and see if they were interested. A lot of times they did take these ideas. They were very good ideas, but unfortunately, in a lot of corporations, everybody has to get their finger in the pie, and so consequently, what came out the other end was often different than what we dreamed up here in Eugene. But it was very exciting from the standpoint that there were no boundaries as far as being innovative and trying something.
Great. If I read one of the articles correctly, one of the ideas was that a lot of runners were getting hurt or ankle and knee injuries. So one of the things that you folks had explored was maybe broadening or widening the sole of a shoe.
Yes, we did do that. And some of the early ideas were providing a little better platform under the foot for better support. It's kind of interesting, when running got underway in the 70s, there was the first Nike shoe store was here in town. And Jeff Hollister, a close friend of mine, was a manager. And unfortunately, Jeff died just yesterday. Mm-hmm. But he came to me and said, you know, we've got all these runners out here and they're getting hurt. We don't know what to do with them. What do we do? Would you be interested in seeing them? So that's how I got my introduction basically into taking care of runners. And we began to look at what was going wrong with the way they ran or the shoes that they ran in. So we tried to design shoes that were more protective of the lower extremity. And it's come a long way since then, but the number of injuries have remained pretty much the same. We found out that it's really the training program that's probably more important. But they moved the standard higher for shoe wear. It's better. It's better designed, and it is more protective.
Okay. What is one thing that you came away after that experience with Bill Bowerman and then your research group? I mean, what is one takeaway that you can tell us?
The thing I took away from that, I think, is the fact that it's you don't have a closed mind when you're starting to think of a new project. Keep your mind open and accept any idea that comes along. It may be good, it may be bad, but if you try to resolve it to one solution immediately, you're going to miss a lot of opportunities to find the right solution.
Hey Stan, you had brought up a good point that when Nike started, they're going against a big giant like Adidas, Nike against Adidas. So just talk a little bit about that.
Well, yes, Adidas had the market on shoe wear for sports, including running at that time. And I don't think anybody thought that a little upstart company out of Oregon, Eugene and Beaverton, Oregon, could conceivably eventually challenge Adidas. And it was just due to the ingenuity of the people involved and some luck that they were able to produce a good product, and now they're bigger than Adidas. So it was, you know, the Goliath fell, basically, although Adidas is still in business, of course. But Nike wasn't afraid to confront them head on with new ideas and a new product, and it worked.
Dr. James, why don't you tell us what attracted you from where you were in Iowa all the way to Eugene? I know that you're a runner before.
Yes, well, I had been on the track team, and I continued running after college, but I interned in Portland, Oregon. And one night I was on the OB-GYN service with a resident from the university in Portland, and I found out he had run in college, so we started talking, and he had run for Bill Bowerman here in Eugene. And in the course of conversation, he mentioned to me that a lot of people, almost everybody in Eugene, runs or jogs. And I never heard of any place where they did that. And this was a program that was actually started by Bill Bowerman, really before the days of the running boom, so to speak, when Ken Cooper, the aerobics guru, made it very, very popular. But they had already started that program in Oregon. And Bill had taken some of his track team members to New Zealand. And there was a very famous coach down there, remember, Arthur Lydiard. Well, while he was down there, Arthur invited him to go out for a run one afternoon because people down there did that. And Bill said, well, yeah, we're going to, Lydiard said, we're going to run over to that mountain and back, and everybody's going to do it. Why don't you join us? So Bill thought, well, that'll be no problem with these people. Well, he soon learned he was at the back of the pack, jogging with some guy that was in his 70s who was hardly breathing, and Bill said he was absolutely out of breath. So that's was his stimulus to start running himself. And when he came back to Eugene, he teamed up with a cardiologist here in town, and they started a jogging program and monitoring how people respond to running and how to improve their health. And that was really the start of the running program in this country.
Wow, so that beginning of this jogging program really changed the world in regards to health and fitness and acceptability of running.
That's right, and then of course Bill, you know, got involved with the shoes and one of his former runners by the name of Phil Knight, and they formed this company called Nike.
So Stan, you're saying that Nike was, when they first started off, were, what you said, one step ahead of the creditors?
That's about right. They were a very marginal company financially. And about 1974 or 75, they designed a shoe called the Nike Waffle Trainer. Now, it was called the Waffle Trainer because it had a sole that looked like a waffle. And that was a design that Bill Bowerman developed. And actually, he used his wife's waffle iron to make these rubber outsoles initially. And it was put upon this shoe and was marketed as the Waffle Trainer about 1975. And that shoe just went right over the top. It was so popular. And Nike was off and going financially, and they never stopped. They've been running ever since.
So it was just experimentation. Sometimes, like you said, you know, like maybe one payroll from being bankrupt and just exploring new ideas and one takes off.
That's right. And Bill got the materials to make the initial waffle soles from one of the tire companies in town here. Went down and got some of their rubber product. And then used his wife's waffle iron to make this waffle imprint into this rubber, which was cut into an outsole to fit onto a shoe. And it was a great innovation.
Well, how did that waffle technology revolutionize running or the running shoe?
Well, it was a great outsole for a shoe. It wore well, and these little waffle pegs gave good cushioning effect and good traction. And then they came up with a good shoe design that the waffle sole went on. And it felt good, and it looked good, and people enjoyed running in it. And it immediately put Nike over the top. Got out of debt, and they were off and going.
Hey, Dr. James, why don't you tell us about Bob Slocum and actually sports medicine? You just shared an interesting tidbit there.
Well, when I came to Eugene in 1967, sports medicine was really in its infancy. In fact, we were looked down upon as jock docs and camp followers, so to speak. But what actually evolved was with this interest in sports medicine and returning people to activity, and responding to the demand of our population to remain more active, sports medicine responded by improving surgical procedures and care of people. And not only did it benefit athletes or people who wanted to be more active throughout their life, it benefited the general population too. Because sports medicine took the challenge and raised the bar and started producing better results. It resulted in extensive research in different areas. And now sports medicine is considered a very integral part of medicine.
Okay. I know that you're such a humble person, but why don't you just say, just one of the great pats in the back that just recently came about, you got an award?
Well, yes, in 2006 I received an award from the College of Medicine at the University of Iowa. It was called the Distinguished Alumnus Award for Achievement. And a little bit like having your parents say you did okay. And lo and behold, it's going to happen again this summer, but the same award, but for the university this time. And so I'll be going back in June to receive a Distinguished Alumnus Award for Achievement from the University of Iowa. And it's based upon my experience in sports medicine and what I was able to do there.
Well, thanks so much, Dr. James, for sharing your stories and your experiences. I know we've all benefited from it. Yeah. Thank you. God bless you.
Sometimes, you know, you live long enough, they forget all the things you did wrong and remember the things you did right. And you reach a point in your life, I guess, where suddenly it's for achievements rather than what you're doing at the time, perhaps. But it's many people were involved in that, you know. You don't do anything by yourself.
Yeah.
You have a lot of support.
That's so good. That's a good word. Well, with that, say thank you so much, and God bless you.
Good.